lots of reading, but this is a chapter that we should be reading often. So if you hear it read a couple of times, it just means that you'll go home with it on your heart. So Matthew 25:31-46. When you have it, you can stand up, or Sister Max, maybe you could put it back on the screen. It was there for the responsive reading for those who don't have it. Are we okay? When the Son of Man comes in his glory and all the angels with him, he will sit on his glorious throne. All the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate the people one from another as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. He will put the sheep on the right and the goats on the left. Then the king will say to those on the right, "Come, you who are blessed by my Father, take your inheritance, the kingdom prepared for you since the creation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you invited me in. I needed clothes, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you looked after me. I was in prison, and you came and visited me." Then the righteous will answer him, "Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you something to drink? When did we see you a stranger and invite you in, or needing clothes and clothe you? When did we see you sick or in prison and go to visit you?" Then the king will reply, "Truly I tell you, whatever you did for one of the least of these brothers and sisters of mine, you did it for me." Then he will say to those on the left, "Depart from me, you who are cursed into eternal fire, prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you gave me nothing to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me nothing to drink. I was a stranger, and you did not invite me in. I needed clothes, and you did not clothe me. I was sick and in prison, and you did not look after me." They also will answer, "Lord, when did we see you hungry or thirsty, or a stranger needing clothes, or sick in prison, and did not help you?" He will reply, "Truly, I tell you, whatever you did not do for one of the least of these, you did not do for me." Then they will go away to eternal punishment, but the righteous will have eternal life. That's not only for doing for the prisoner. That's doing for everybody, prisons or not. Thank you so much. We're here this morning because we serve a God of love, a God who cares for us. We are here today, as I was supposed to speak about prison, but I'm going to give you a lesson, little message. And I'm going to go through that, and I'll pick up on the end. And so this, it reads in Isaiah 42:6-7, it says, "I, the Lord, have called you in righteousness and will hold your hand. I will keep you, and I will give you a covenant to the people, as a light to the Gentiles, to open blind eyes, to bring out prisoners from the prisons, those who sit in darkness from prison houses." This is the word of Isaiah. The word of Isaiah, what I've just read, means part of a Christian's mission here on earth is to demonstrate God's righteousness and be a light for the Gentiles. Not only the Gentiles, but to all nations. Through Christ, all people have an opportunity to share in his mission. God calls us to be his servants, the servants of his Son, demonstrating God's righteousness and being his light. What a rare privilege it is to help the Messiah fulfill his light. What a rare, to provide and fill his life. What a rare privilege it is to help each other. We must seek the righteousness in Matthew 6:33, which says, before we demonstrate others to others, and let it, we must be prepared to let our light shine in us before we can be lights to others. Before we can tell somebody else what to do, we must get our lights trimmed and burning for Christ so that people will see the light of Christ shining into others. And we must be able to reach out make a difference. Well, we aim to differ with them. You as a stranger, see you as a stranger and take you in, and naked enclose you, or when did we see you sit in prison and come to you? And the king will answer them, saying, assuredly I say, inasmuch as you did this for the one of these, least of these brethren, I would do it for you. So God, we know that God has done all of this for us, and God wants us to do the same for our brothers and sisters. Here we see Jesus, our Lord Christ, identifying himself, the one who was hungry, he was thirsty, a stranger, a prisoner, and calling us to minister of hearing, outreach, witness, and justice. Thus, any so-called prison ministry will be an outreach to Christian in Christian love. Any compassion not only to prisoners and their families, but also crime prevention and their families. And the community at large, encompassing the criminal justice and the correctional system and the people who work in it. In the past, society would say, lock them up and throw away the key. Have many of you heard that situation? When somebody has a crime, you just want to condemn them forever. But God does not do that. Amen. Yet we know that people come out of prison only to commit more crime. They return to prison and they get stuck in the cycle of the revolving door of crime and release. The answer is not more prisons, not more prisons so that we can lock more people up. It is not even the death penalty so that we can lock, not even the death penalty, as studies have shown that even this is not the effective damage. The answer is the gospel of Jesus Christ, the redemption and the transforming power of God's love. Putting people aside and ignoring people is not going to do the trick. Love others the way that God loves you. Never stop being patient. Never stop believing God. Never stop hoping and never give up on our Christian life. Our mission is reaching out to prisons. More than 2 million prisoners are being held in the federal state prisons, in our local jails, buildings, and maintaining prisons is one of the fastest growing industries in the United States and Canada. Yet, many of us feel that the ministry is better left to the professionals, prison chaplains, or those specially trained for this kind of work and has no place in a normal Christian ministry. We are making a big mistake when we think that way. When most people think of prisoners, they envision a sense of that television show Oz or Dead Man Walking. If any of you seen those? This is how people think of Christians. But here we see Jesus, our Lord, Jesus Christ, identifying himself with prisoners, and we also need to do the same. Never stop being patient, and never stop believing, never stop hoping, and never stop giving up. The same love that God gives us, we are to offer to everybody else that we come in contact with. It's not an option or a suggestion, it is a command. Now I'm giving you a new command. Love each other just as I have loved you. You should love each other. That's taken from God's word, John 13, verse 34. If you are a follower of Christ, you must love everybody, whether you like them or not. That can be hard, but this is what the scripture says. In the same way Christ loved us, that we are to accept them completely, love them unconditionally, forgive them totally, and to lift them up. We need to love them and let them know how much we love them so that they won't reoffend and go back. I can remember many years ago, one person was in prison and came out of prison and came to this church. And no sooner he entered the church, there was a finger wag. Isn't that the so-and-so who was in jail for what he did, and he heard it and he never came back? We should have said, love yourself, brother. We're so glad to see you here. Is there anything I can do to help you? That's how we should approach people. Loving others the way that God loved us. Loving others is a way that will transform our relationships with each other. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians, love never stops being patient, never stops believing, never stops hoping, and it never gives up. This is how God loves us. God never stops being patient with us. And you know, some of us, in times, we can be hard people to be patient with. But never stop, God never stops being patient with us. God never stops believing in us. Even when other people believe that we're no good or we can't do anything. We are all precious in God's sight. God treats us all equally. None of us are no better than the other. We all make mistakes, but we know who to go to when we make a mistake. Just because you make a mistake, you shouldn't be put on the back burner and not getting help. Because when we make mistakes and others can see, they might have made the same mistake. They can come alongside of you and say, I was in the same position, but this is how I dealt with it. Don't cast them down. God never stops hoping for the best of life for all of us. God never gives up on us. That's what God expects us to do with everyone. God expects us to do this with everyone. Love never stops being patient. As I said, this means love extends grace. We need to offer grace to each other. Excuse me. Love never stops believing. That means it expresses faith. Turn to the next person beside you and tell them, even though we may be having a tough time, I will never stop believing in you. Say that to someone near you. You may be having a tough time, but we will never stop believing in each other, because we all have something to learn, and we need each other. Love never stops hoping. This means love expects the best. Are you expecting the best in your marriage, or have you settled for less? Are you expecting the best of love from your family, or have you settled for less than the best? Are you expecting the best of love from your Christians and brothers and sisters and your fellowship in the church, or have you settled for less? We should never, never settle for less. Love never gives without. This means love endures the worst. It means that you can look at another person and say, you can throw anything you have at me, but I'm going to love you no matter what. Because if we expect to get in God's kingdom, we need to change our hearts. And we need to love people for who they are and stop pointing fingers at one another. Our number one message to the inmates is to let them know how much God loves them. When we go there, we tell them, God loves you the same as he loved us. You did something that you caused you in here. Some of us in this circle could be walking around who did the same thing, but we didn't get caught. You got caught, and so you're in here. So we're not coming here to look down on you. We're coming here to lift you up and let you know God loves you. We started going to prison because we saw a need to present the gospel to the inmates. I remember we had a large Sunday school adult Bible class. I had 36 in that class. And I remember Sister Ada Clayton so vividly. We used to go around this community, and we used to go into the institutions taking the word and preaching to people. And one Sunday she said, why don't we go to the prisons? I says, I had never thought of that. I didn't know that we would be allowed. She said, we did it when we were in New Brunswick. I said, praise the Lord. I'll check it out, and we'll see if that's possible. We checked it out, and we saw that it was possible, but we have to train. Her and I trained and took the training and brought it back and trained the others. And when we did that, the gospel of prison ministry started. We prayed that God would cleanse us so that we would go in there. We had 36 in our class, but 36 were not people that wanted to go into the prison. I remember one lady who went, and she said, when I went in, going to the chapel, and when that door shut behind me, I just couldn't take it. So everybody is not geared to go into the prisons to do prison ministry. But we have a great crowd of prison team volunteers. We work very well together. And in order to be in the prison, we do not support the crimes that the people do. That's not what we go there for. We can't even talk about what crimes they do. But they need to know there is a God who forgives them. He forgives them and he gives them a second chance. And make some good choices in life. If nobody goes there to tell them about Jesus, how will they ever know? Some of them have never, ever been inside of a church door. There's a choice. They don't have to come down to the chapel if they don't want to, but they do. The last Sunday that I was there, they built a new chapel in Truro now, and it's a larger chapel. There were 36 women in that chapel. And when leaving that chapel, one black girl came and she asked for a Bible. And she says, I'm going to give my heart to the Lord. And so when you see this, it gives us a reason to want to go. We can tell you many great stories. We don't just go to the prison for the color of the skins that we witness to. Because red and yellow and black and white, we all need Jesus. And there's times when we go to a prison, we might not even see a black person. But we have those who want to change in their life and want to hear the word of God. And we get many, many, as somebody said, you sow many seeds, you don't even think you're sowing a seed until you get on the outside and you hear from those who you have witnesses to. I could tell you many stories about the people we ran into, who we witnessed to, that we didn't even know. I remember at a Billy Graham crusade, there's a young man came, and we were there because I was part of that team. And here when it was in Halifax, and he picked me up and swung me around, and everybody was looking at me, and I'm at him. And I'm saying, where do I know you from? He said, you witnessed to me in prison, and I'm now a member of a certain church, and I am doing very well, and I have no intentions of going. Another meeting I went to with a group of women, and there was a lady there taking the minutes. I didn't know, remember her, she remembered me, and when it was all over, she said, do you remember me? I said, no, I don't. She said, you witnessed to me in prison. Your team witnessed to me in prison. And here she's out of prison, not to go back, and she's active in a women's group, taking minutes. So there is good news. There is good news in going into the prison, sowing seeds because you're touching their heart. I had one young man who went to prison and asked if I were coming to visit him on one-on-one. I do that quite often. And when I went, he thought I wasn't coming because there were three other people he requested to come and didn't show. I witnessed to him until he got out. Then he gave his heart to the Lord and he says, I want to be baptized. I said, I'm not here selling our church, I'm selling Jesus. Now, you can go where, because he wasn't from this community, wherever you want to be baptized, it's your choice. I will support you and I'll be there. And so he made that decision and he asked if I would be there. So I said, okay, I'll ask the pastor, because he wanted me to stand with him when he gave his testimony. And he wanted me to be with him and carry his blankets when he got baptized. So I had a lot of asking to do. So I asked the pastor, he said, not a problem. Then I asked the parents. The parents said, we'll take a back seat. This young man was 32 years old. He said, you don't know how we had tried to witness We will take a back seat and you'll be there. It took me 35 minutes to drive to that church, but when I got there, the parents were sitting in the back, the young father was sitting in the front, with the blankets on the seat waiting for me. So that is telling the gospel, that's sharing the gospel. And you should never, never, never give up. You may ask, why prison ministry? Prison ministry is a command by the Lord Jesus Christ, and we have read that in Matthew a couple of times this morning. Many jails and prisons have no full-time or even part-time chaplains or any religious service at all. Even in prisons that have chaplains, they cannot possibly minister to more than a small percentage of inmates there. Statistics tells us that every person incarcerated, there are 3 to 5 other people affected. Families, loved ones, and children. If you ever have somebody in prison, you feel just as bad because instead of people coming to help you, they're looking down on you, saying that you made a mistake. If you hadn't did this, maybe they wouldn't have ended up. These are all the things that's running through people's minds. But we need to come alongside our families. We need to love them. We need to love children. And that is why in the prison system, they have an Angel Tree project, which you'll be hearing about soon, which we participate in. And this is for the children of inmates. The inmates are in prison, they can't buy a gift. But they are given a form that is filled out so they can put their child's name and address on that form. And they can send it out, and churches pick those forms up, and they'll suggest a gift. And you are able to purchase a gift, not more than $30, or purchase a gift card. So we hope to have the names of 50, and if we don't get names of 50, we will get a $30 gift card, and we'll send it where we can't deliver. But where we can deliver, we will deliver, and we will give a Christian message to the families. And you never know who's going to open those doors. And one of the things is, never go alone. A woman cannot go alone delivering. You have to have a man with you, because you never know how you're going to be accepted. And you meet good people, and you meet people who just want to take the gift. You meet people who want to give a thank you, but we can't tell them that we did it. It's a gift from the person in prison. It's not from us or not from our church. It's a gift from your father or your mother in prison. That's how we tell the message to them, that they love you, and there's a little message that we can put on. And I thank you, the whole church, because every year for the last few years, you've been taking those names off of those trees, which we hope to put up here in a couple of weeks, and you've been helping some poor innocent child that their parents are in prison. And it's so heartbreaking when you know the mother is in prison and not going to be spending time with their children. So anything that we can do to make the families happier at Christmas time, we do that. What is expected of us when we go to prison? Number one, I told you about this Angel Tree thing. Once we get that information and we do deliver, we got to destroy it. We can't tell anybody. That's why even members of our prison team do not know the places we live, deliver, because we have a few people who do this on behalf of the team, because we have to be confidential. We cannot spread people's gospel around. When we go into the prisons, it says nothing in and nothing out. That means if someone gives us a message to take to somebody there, we can't tell them. If they give us a message to bring out, we can't tell them. And I remember the first time that we went to a noose, and I remember, Deacon Fred, where are you? That Deacon Fred and myself was the drivers. And that Saturday, we went going to a noose. We left very early in the morning. I don't know if any of the prison ministry team is here that was on that trip. It was a cold Saturday morning, and there was a lot of black ice. And Deacon Freddie was slowing down a little too often for me. So I passed him, and he started blinking his lights. But I kept right on going. When we got to the noose, Freddie said, "You were driving dangerously. You didn't realize the road was slippery with black ice." I said, "Well, God slid me right on him." I did not feel any prettiness. I just kept on driving. I said, I'm going to have to keep with her. Coming back, we were in the worst snowstorm that we were ever in. And it took us 5 hours to get from New Brunswick back home. But people were praying for us. When I got home, my phone was full with messages how people were praying for us. So God split us in, and the people prayed us back. So we were blessed. And so we have visitors, we have visitors, so we can say, and that first visit that I went to Renews, nothing in and nothing out. That was the first time. And there was one lady in this community gave me an envelope to give to her son because it was Christmas. And not knowing it as much or hadn't paid attention to it, I took the envelope boldly and said, this is from your grandmother. And the chaplain comes to me and he says, what did you give him? And I said, I gave him a present from his grandmother. He said, you can't give it to him, you have to give it to me. I said, well, I didn't know. But I didn't get to after that, nothing in, nothing out. Our team members realized nothing in, nothing out, because everything that goes in that prison has to be checked by the security before it is passed on. So we are really keen on that. We have an excellent record. We have never had any problems with our team in 37 years. Going to prison, breaking the law. And we can't, many of them can't say it, and I'm just gonna boast a little bit. We are the number one team that's been going to the prisons, and they tell us that, and we get a full chapel. Every time we go, they want to know what Sunday is East Preston coming. And when we delivered in Burnside, the women left Burnside and went to Nova, and they requested we come to Nova. We said, we can't go to Nova every week, it's too far. But I says, I'll try it for a year, and if it works, we'll go. Well, we've been going ever since Nova Institute opened. One second we drove there, when we were driving on the highway, it was a bad storm. One of those big wheelers, those trucks, transforming trucks, took us right through the Truro. We drove behind that. And every time I think about the chances we took on those highways, and we have never, ever had an accident. I mean, remember one time I picked up a prisoner, one of our volunteers, and we spin right around in the road over here by the Patrick River. And I said, why are we going to continue on when we're right in Preston? It's a bad night. And all the way up the highway, the devil was saying to me, these prisoners are in prison. They're not on the highway. Why are you risking your life? But I'm telling you, when we got to that prison that night, what a service we had. It just changed my whole idea, and it lifted my spirits. And then I remember Sister Marianne Glasgow, who was on a team, she gave a prayer that night. And there was a new chaplain there. And he was curious because he had only been there for a month. And he said, what are they going to say to help these prisoners? But she prayed. And she prayed for him that when difficult come, that he would know what to do. Well, 2 days later, I got a call. He said, guess what? He said, he told me how he was making fun, saying, why are we here? He said he got a call that this one of the inmates, mother and father, had got killed in a car crash in Montreal. And he had to tell him. And he said, if it hadn't been for that prayer that was given by Sister Marianne Glasgow, I don't think I'd have had the courage to do it. So there's power in prayer. So he confessed his lack of knowledge. He confessed what he thought. But God turned it around to make it good. So we can say, praise God from whom all blessings flow. Our team members are committed and have been committed. Today, we were going to honor or make one of our team members an honorary member, but she was not able to be here today, Sister Peggy Florence Carter. That woman, even though another one of our committed members who is already an honorary member. These ladies commit themselves to the team. And I can remember Aunt Phyllis telling us, she said, by you asking me to go on that prison ministry team, it has made me stronger. And that's what it's all about. We have to lift each other up and care for them. So we want to take care and visit our honorary people. that we make honorary members and let them know we still love them. We are committed to sharing the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ with unconditional love. We are there to assist and support families. We have taken requests from the prison chaplains at a Christmas when there was a young man in there and his family had nothing. Our team members collected everything that family needed for Christmas and delivered it. We prepared inmates for re-entry into society, physically, mentally, morally, and spiritually. We provide practical advice when needed. When needed, we provide advice. There's some things you can say and there's some things you can't say. But we know that all we can do is point them to Christ. We have visited every prison ministry institution in New Brunswick and Nova Scotia. Not on a regular basis, but Truro and in Burnside, we go every month. We have visited Renouse, Spring Hill, Watermill Youth Center, Central Nova Burnside, Nova Institute in Truro, and so on. We show love and compassion to the inmates. We counsel with them, and we have assisted their families. We deliver Christmas gifts through the Angel Tree Project, and we do special services at Easter time, Black History Month, and then we have been there for a number of special services, Christmas, Easter, and Black History Month. We take a special service there to the inmates, and they appreciate it so much. But above all, I hope I give you a little bit of knowledge of how important it is to love, how important it is to respect each other, how important it is to not to put each other down and not to put prisoners down, how important it is for us to remember how Christ loved us, and we should love each other even when we don't like them. As I said, we love them anyway, because that is a command from God. And I just want to read one thing in closing. I was doing my devotions on Saturday morning, and it's just a coincidence that this came up, this reading. It's from the woman's devotional Bible. And every so often throughout that Bible, there's little writings. So Hebrews 13 is based on Hebrews 13. And the author who wrote this story, her name is Mary C. Crowley. And it's titled, Never Give Up. The great Russian writer, tells the bravest story I've ever heard to encourage us not to give up. The Russian prisoner where he was, no one was allowed to speak. There was nothing to read and no encouragement of any kind to assist his life. He said, the strain and repercussion from this atmosphere had set in so badly that he thought, I will never get out of here. So he considered taking his own life. He knew that if he tried to escape, that he would be shot. But he thought, at least, that would be over. His faith would not allow him to do that. Though, when day came, he was taken out early in the morning to work. And when a break in the workday came, he sat under a tree. He even placed his hand behind his head. Up against the tree, he leaned again, ready to push off and run. Just then, a shadow came across the grass, and a fellow prisoner sat down beside him. They could not speak, no words, but he looked into the eyes of the new man who had recently came to a prison, and he saw something that he had never seen in anyone's face in prison before, a message of love and concern. As their eyes looked in silence, they started communicating in their souls, and the prisoner took a step forward, and he drew a cross on the ground with a stick. The writer said, new hope surged within him at that moment. Jesus does love me, he said, commanded, it is not hopeless. 3 days later, he was released from that prison. As he was released, he learned that many people had been praying for him. He knew with powerful certainty that God is sovereign, and there is still hope. We must give up. We mustn't give up. We might be the one to communicate hope to someone else. Maybe a gesture, maybe with a word. We must love and pray and hold on to each other. And Hebrews 13 says, keep on loving each other as brothers. Do not forget to entertain strangers. For by doing so, some people have entertained angels without knowing it. Remember those in prison as if you were their fellow prisoners, and those who are ministers as if you yourself were suffering. Never will I leave you, never will I forsake you. So we say with confidence, the Lord is my helper. I will not be afraid. Then what can man do to harm me? Nothing. God is our helper and our maker. So let us love him. So that is my little message to you about prison. I hope you learned something.